Hi, welcome to Art on the Brain. This is Kelly Drake, and today I'm going to show you how to paint foliage in watercolor. The first thing you're going to need is a drawing of some tree branches. You could draw them any way you like. And we're going to be using some masking fluid to leave white and to make those branches really stand out. So the first thing I want you to do is take an inexpensive brush and coat it with water and some liquid soap to protect the brush from the masking fluid. Then you could shape it into a nice point if you want to. This will make your brushes last a lot longer if you're using them with masking fluid, to always get into the habit of putting a little soft soap on first. So this is the masking fluid I'm using. You can see it's slightly tinted and off-white so that you can see it when you put it on. You can also see the shine. And this is a good way to leave white if you have an intricate pattern or a detail that you want to leave with watercolor. And if you've painted with watercolor before, you know how important leaving white is, because there is no actual white watercolor paint that you use in traditional watercolors. If you have white paint with your set, that's actually gouache, and it's an opaque color and really shouldn't be used with the traditional watercolor painting. So now I have my branches all masked out, and for the most part, I'm just going to take a tiny brush and get those little detailed branches. And I think these little details are what really makes the painting interesting to look at. It's these little branches that give it the character. And when you're putting the masking fluid on, try to avoid putting too much masking fluid over the pencil lines. You don't want to protect those lines, but just paint just inside of those. Now I let that dry, and I'm going to use my big wash brush and just get the whole page wet with clear water. So we're going to do a nice green wash back there to start out our foliage. And it's okay at this point with clear water to lift out a couple things off your page if you have a little hair or a little speck of something that gets stuck on there. But when you're painting, it's best to just leave those things until it dries and then brush them off. Use my round brush and really load it up with some of this beautiful green color. This is, I believe it's an olive green. I usually use Daniel Smith colors because I just like their selection of colors, and I like the way the paint looks on the page. There's a lot of really beautiful colors that you don't have to mix, and you have beautiful color right out of the tube. This is a green gold, and I'm just putting that in the center, kind of thinking that there might be a sunlit area there where the branches have some sunlight hitting them. And it's darkening some of the edges here. I like to get plenty of color on there in the water because I know it's going to dry lighter than what it looks like now. I'm using some plastic wrap. This is a trick that we have to, and this really looks like leaves in the background when it dries, and I like to scrunch it up quite a bit if I want to have a small leaf pattern. So I'm using lots of plastic wrap on this one, crunching it up quite a bit, and then pressing it down. When you press it down, you can see the pattern evolving underneath the plastic wrap. You really see a pretty good indication of what you're going to get when it's dry. So while it's wet like this, you can really mess around with it quite a bit to get the pattern that you want. I'm just going to make sure it's all covered with plastic wrap so I don't have any areas that don't have that foliage design. You could look close up and kind of see some of that pattern that's evolving underneath the plastic wrap. Now, you have to leave this to dry for quite a while because the plastic holds in the water. So just leave, have a cup of coffee, eat some lunch, something like that, before you come back and try to take the plastic wrap off. If you pull up a little area and take a peek, you can see whether it's dry enough or not. Well, this was dry, so I took it all off. And although I love the pattern that's back there, I think it's a little pale. So what I'm going to do is just use a paper towel with a tiny bit of water, just damp, clean off a little bit of the paint that's on those masking fluid areas. And then I'm going to do a second layer of plastic wrap and paint over the areas that I want a little more of that foliage pattern and just a little more color. So there's my green gold that I started out with, that sunlight that is hitting in the middle of the branches. And that's the area really where I want the eye to go. The branches are the most interesting there, and that's where I want the sunlight to hit. And it's pretty close to that one-thirds rule, where it's one-third from the top, about one-third from the side. You know, it's not exactly perfect, but it's close. So just putting one more layer of plastic wrap and messing with the pattern here till I get a little closer to what I want. Press it down real well. Now over in this area, I want it to be a little darker. And so I'm just going to get that wet, put in a little of, this is called undersea green, and it's nice because it goes in nicely with these more natural green colors, but it's more of a blue green, so you get a little variety there, and it's a great color for shadows in with this green foliage. So just gonna spread it around there a little bit, grab some more of my plastic wrap after I clean up the edges. This is a nice trick if you have a little too much water to just kind of run a paper towel along the edge without touching the paper, and it kind of soaks up a little bit of that excess water that you don't want on your paper. Now with this one, because you use a lot of water, I had used an inexpensive piece of paper here from a pad, a watercolor pad, and was a little bit annoyed when it got wavy and warbled and had some puddles of water here and there. As you can see while I'm pulling that plastic wrap away, I got a little bit impatient and pulled it away too early, and this is what happens when you do that. It's still okay, you just have to let it dry. And I let it dry, and there it really does look fine. Still has the pattern there. So as I was saying, this would be a better project on better paper. I would suggest a 140-pound Arches cold press or a Winsor Newton cold press, Lan Aquarelle. Those kind of papers would be much better suited to this than this inexpensive paper that I used. It still works, but it's just a little more work trying to soak up extra water here and there where it puddles on the paper. You'd rather have that paper lie flat and not have to mess with that. But hey, if you're just practicing and you want to try it out, you don't need to go spend a lot of money. Just give it a try, and then if you're really liking it and you're getting good results, break out the nicer paper and you'll just see what a difference that makes. So now I just wanted to put some more rich color in here, and because watercolor is transparent, those leafy patterns will show through. You know, this might obscure a little bit of that, but they are in the background, so that's okay. I like some of the foliage to shine through and some of that just colored wash to give it a more ethereal look. Now you can see the shine on the paper here on the left, those puddles forming. And so I'm going to lift this up and have the water go off to the side. You can see where the masking fluid is. It's going to catch some of those puddles. And you can pick it up and use your same paper towel technique to kind of soak it up without touching the paper. And it's good to do that, or you'll end up with some blooms in there that you don't want, some water blooms. Now this won't happen so much with nicer paper, so just can't emphasize that enough. I thought, I'll give it a try on this paper, see how it goes, and it was fine, but not ideal. So now everything's dry, and I'm going to peel off that masking fluid, which to me is kind of fun. It peels off like, I don't even know if it's like glue, or it's like a latex rubbery material, and sometimes you could just peel it off in big long sheets. I haven't said, but I want to make sure that you know that you really can't leave the masking fluid on your paper longer than about 24 hours. You might be able to push that a little bit, but don't leave it on too long or you'll be very disappointed. It doesn't come off like it should, and you'll get stuck with a rubbery latex mess on your paper, especially the less expensive paper. So make sure if you're going to use masking fluid to take it off after 24 hours, and especially if you're using nicer paper, you can go ahead and reapply that one or two times if you need to in places. It's better to do that than to leave it on too long, believe me. So now I have mixed a neutral to go in and paint these branches, and I'm going to be very careful to leave white where I think the light is hitting the branches. So I've kind of created a light area in the background where the sun is hitting, and so I'm going to leave white wherever I feel like that sun might be touching these branches. The way I mix this neutral is to take some of that olive green and mix in some red, and I used anthracnoid red. I can't believe I said that. I always have trouble saying that word, but that's also, I believe, a Daniel Smith color that I'm using. But in mixing that olive green and red, two complementary colors, I can come up with quite a few variations of this neutral, and it's going to look good with this background of green because it has some of that green in it, and so it's not going to clash. And it's going to make a very natural color that will look more like a real branch rather than if you just use brown out of the tube, like a burnt umber or a sienna. This is going to look more like an actual tree branch color. It's good to mix your colors when you're painting something natural, something from nature, because a lot of times the colors right out of the tube are just not colors that you see when you're outside. So now I'm just getting that neutral darker and emphasizing the shadows on the branches so they'll just stand out a little more against that white. I want more contrast in the foreground so that stands out. And I want the foliage to be a backdrop in this painting. And you can see on that bigger branch down low that some of the paint is granulating. And I like that effect when you're painting wood or something with texture on it. It's going to give it some texture without you having to paint it on with a tiny brush. So mixing colors, like mixing that green and red, often will give you a granulation, and some of the green and red will separate out a little bit. I really like that effect, and hopefully you like that as well. You'll have to take some of your colors and just test them and mix them in your art journal or sketchbook or on a separate piece of paper and just let them dry and see what they do. Put them down in some water together and see if they granulate or if they don't, if the colors separate out, and then you'll know what your palette does and you'll know which colors to use when you're ready. So this area is still, I want to get darker and I want to have a natural looking wash. So I put some clear water down and some more dark neutral. This one I mixed warmer. There's a little more red in this one. And putting that on top of the little bit cooler neutral below. So now you can see it's looking a little more brown than gray. And it's nice to just have a combination of neutrals too, so that it's not all one color. When you go out and look at a tree branch or a tree trunk and you look at it very closely, you'll see lots of color in there. There's greens, there's grays, there's browns, there's gold sometimes. There's a lot of color mixed in there. So we're going to try to simulate that here with a lighter neutral, cooler neutral made with the green and red that separates out a little bit, and now going over with a kind of a greenish gray brown color. There's actually a lot of color all mixed in there that makes it look a little more realistic. Now that I think of it, I should tell you that for that cool gray, I did mix the olive green and anthracnoid red, as well as a little bit of cerulean blue to make it cooler. So now I had to switch to a smaller brush to get into these little tiny areas, and trying to put in some shadow there so it looks somewhat natural. Try to vary your strokes and your widths. And right now I'm just trying to put in some little shadows that show where some tree branches overlap others. So keep in mind where your light is coming from. And you can just put a tiny bit of a darker neutral there wherever the branch crosses over. And that gives a little bit more of a 3D effect. So now I'm just painting wet over dry, and I get a little bit harder edge that way than I did when I painted into the water down below there. And as long as that paint is still a little bit wet, you can continue to move that edge along the branch until you get what you like. Once it dries, you have to really stop yourself and wait until it's totally dry, and then continue to paint. If it just starts to dry, you don't see any shine on the paper, you have to stop and work in another area or go somewhere else and come back to your painting so that you don't end up with a lot of blooms where you don't want them. This paper, this inexpensive paper from the pad, is interesting because what it does is some areas will dry faster than others. Other areas will stay very wet, depending on how the paper warps. And so it makes it a little more difficult to work with. If you haven't worked with a nicer paper yet, I would say just try, get a piece and try it. Cold press is, I think, the easiest to work with if you've never worked with watercolor paper before. Hot press is more difficult, and it shows all your mistakes. You might want to just give it a try, because actually, if you're just starting out painting with watercolor, that nicer paper is actually going to make the whole job easier for you. Even if you got 90 pound and stretched it and worked it, it would be more forgiving than this is. So now I'm done with my paper lecture. You don't have to listen to that anymore. So now just finishing up these branches. And up here I'm getting even a little darker because there's those dark branches back there. So I want quite a bit of contrast in the foreground, and I want that white to really stand out. So whatever you do in one place, you have to kind of mix it. You have to spread it around your painting so that you don't have one thing sticking out, unless that's your plan. So I'm going to put some of this neutral in all the branches around this painting, but I'm going to vary the values so that they don't all look exactly alike. So some areas will be darker than others, some areas will be lighter, just like if you looked at an actual tree out in the forest. So now I think I'm about done with this tree painting. I'm going to let it dry and very carefully remove the tape that I put on there when I was stretching my paper, and try to pull away from the painting so that if it does rip a little bit, hopefully it will rip the paper on the outside and not the actual painting. I use blue 3M tape, which seems to work really well and has very little tearing when you take it off. Again, don't leave the tape on very long, just like the masking fluid. You probably should take it off in 20 to 48 hours. So this is my beautiful painting of the trees and the lighted foliage in the background. As you can see, anyone can do this. It's actually very simple. All you need is some masking fluid, watercolor paints, and some plastic wrap. So I really hope you've enjoyed this demonstration, and I hope you give it a try at home. If you have any comments or questions for me, please leave them below in the comments section, and also include a picture of what you've done. It would be really great to see. Also, please take a little time to like this video and subscribe to my channel if you'd like to see more like this. And if you want to know more about me, my artwork, and my children's books, please check out my website and my Facebook page.